Lord, we sit and stand before you this afternoon, and our desire is that we will hear from you alone. We desire, King of Glory, that your word will come through with clarity, O God, and that it will bear fruit in our lives, fruit that will last to the glory and honor of your name. And so my prayer this afternoon is that may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing unto you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Praise the Lord. We are reading through Colossians, and this is a small book, and so I want to interest you into reading this book. And it is one of those books that you will find things that will challenge you as an individual, but also as a body of Christ. Now, I want to begin by kind of laying a foundation so that we can understand what actually happens before we get to chapter 2 of the book. So who is it that pens this important book for us down? If you read chapter 1 and verse 1, you will realize that the writer is Apostle Paul, and he does write while in prison. And that for me made a lot of sense, but also challenged me, because many times if you found yourself in a place like a prison, many times you spend all your energies sad and worried, and so you do not engage in a lot of productive activity. But here is a servant of God, Paul the Apostle, in prison, but he still finds that he can use that time for something productive. Now, if you read Acts chapters 27 and 28, you will know that Paul was in Rome, but in a prison. And why he was arrested is simply because he was going about teaching people and preaching to them the good news of Jesus Christ, calling them to be saved and telling them that Christ is the Lord. And for just that reason, the Apostle Paul gets arrested. So he writes, the group he writes to is to God's holy people at Colossae, and that is in verse 2 of chapter 1. These were believers in the Lord that lived in a geographical place called Colossae. Interesting that Paul had actually never met them. Many times Paul writes letters to churches he started and to people he had met before. But what makes Colossians unique is that he had never had a physical meeting or encounter with these people. In fact, he did not start the church at Colossae. Now, the church at Colossae was started by his friend, a co-worker of Paul in the Lord, named Epaphras, and he was actually from that city. If you read in Acts 19 and verse 10, you will get a story of how this young man, Epaphras, was at Ephesus one time, and as Paul walked about to preach the word of God, Epaphras was moved and convicted by the Spirit of God. He gets saved, and he tells Paul, you know what? What I have received is so rich that I do not want to keep it to myself. And so he decides to go back to his town at Colossae to teach this good news to the people. And as he teaches this good news, people come to the Lord, and that is how the church begins at Colossae. Now, what prompts Paul to write to this church he never started? The occasion is this man Epaphras takes some time off. He goes to Rome to visit Paul. He tells him the church has started, people are growing. But he also tells him of the challenges that they had. And some of these challenges Epaphras mentions to Paul, they were pressures coming from outside the church that were seemingly wanting to divide the body of believers. And so upon hearing this disturbing message, Paul decides to sit and he writes this letter for majorly three reasons. One is to encourage them. To encourage them in the Lord, but also to address some of the issues that Epaphras had raised, but lastly, to challenge them to be committed to Jesus Christ, whom they had believed. Praise the Lord. Now, this letter is easy to follow. It is kind of divided into four sections, and I want to interest you in that before I even get to chapter two. The letter begins with an opening movement that talks about the supremacy of Jesus Christ as the exalted Messiah. In fact, 23 verses of chapter 1 are simply telling us who Jesus Christ is and how superior he is compared to other gods. He is the exalted Messiah, and he is the one that Epaphras preached. He is the one that these people believed. So having given us the credentials of Christ as Messiah, who is exalted above these other gods, Paul then goes on to show us that he is actually suffering in prison because of this exalted Messiah. He tells them, you know what, the reason I am in chains, the reason I am in prison is because of this exalted Messiah. And this happens from verse 24 of chapter 1 and runs all through to chapter 2 and verse 5. Having told them about the cause of his suffering, Paul now addresses the issues. He goes to the heresies that were coming into church, and he addresses them one by one, pointing out what the truth is vis-a-vis the false teaching that had come into the church. And as the letter comes to an end in chapters 3 and 4, Paul now explores this new life that the believers at Colossae had because they received Jesus Christ as their Messiah. Now you will notice that we have read chapter 2, verses 16 to 23, and this text for the afternoon falls in the third division of the book, where Paul is dealing with a heresy that were causing people to kind of want to fall back from the truth of Jesus Christ's message. And so I would like to invite us this afternoon to please journey with me from chapter 2, the beginning verses, so that we actually understand what the gist of the matter is in these verses 16 to 23. Why is it that Paul begins verse 16 by telling us, therefore? Friends, the word therefore indicates that he has said certain things prior, and having laid that foundation clearly, he is therefore calling us to something interesting. Will you go with me to verse 6? Verse 6 of chapter 2 runs all the way to 15, and in this section, Paul mentions that as believers in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we have spiritual fullness in Christ. He tells us that we have received Christ as the Lord of our lives. And so he continues to say, because we have now received Christ, there is need for us to daily continue to be rooted and built up in him. There is need for us to grow in our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And he tells us we ought to be strengthened in this faith as we were taught. But in addition to that, he tells us we ought to overflow with thankfulness. And as he comes to verse 8 of that chapter, he gives us a caution. He tells us you received the true message, but people are coming in to corrupt this message. Do not be deceived. Do not be deceived by these false teachers. Verses 9 to 12, he makes something interesting that I would like to interest us in. He says, for in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. And in Christ, you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. In him, you were also circumcised with a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self ruled by the flesh was put off when you were circumcised by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of the Lord who raised him from the dead. He actually reminds them and us of what happened to us at baptism. Now, many of us know the liturgy and we simply enjoy it, but at baptism, the priest tells us that upon being baptized, our old self has been put down, and behold, we put on a new self. And Paul says, this is what happened to you, remember, when the message was preached. You are no longer your old selves. You have a new self in Christ Jesus. He continues to remind them in verses 13 to 15. He says, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away by nailing it onto the cross, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Hallelujah. Amen. He tells us of what Christ accomplished for us at the cross. And that is the foundation he lays. You were dead in your sin. Christ came and took your place. He gave you a new life. You no longer live for yourselves. You live for him. And so you ought to grow in your faith in Jesus Christ. You ought to grow in your faith. And so you no longer need to live like people that are still putting on the old self. A transition has happened. Will you now live like those that know the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? And that is when he begins saying, therefore. The therefore is because you now belong to the Lord. Listen to what he says in verse 16. Do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, or a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath. So having laid for us the foundation, Paul now calls us to certain things, beginning in verse 16. Now, it is very unfortunate that many times we do certain wrong things in the name of trying to know God and be close to him. Now, if you walked around churches in Kampala, but also here in Mukono, you will see people that have a genuine need to thirst and hunger for the Lord being deceived into doing certain things, and they are told that by doing certain things, you will actually grow close to the Lord. Now, Paul in these verses calls us to be careful. He is dealing with three heresies that were at this church in Colossae. And in these verses, we are going to see three of those. The first is legalism. The second heresy is mysticism, and I will explain these. And the last is asceticism. Now, about legalism, we see this in the first verses. In verses 16 to 17, he is describing a kind of Jewish legalism, the do's and don'ts of the Jewish religion. You have to eat this, you have to avoid eating this, you kind of have to walk a certain way, you have to observe the new moon. There are certain things that Jews did which they thought made them religious people. And Paul is actually reminding us in the Old Testament, we had these laws, the ceremonial laws. If you read the book of Leviticus, you will understand that almost everything had a law. The foods had a law, the drinks had a law, almost everything. And you had to be very careful how you went about these things. Now, as Paul mentions these friends, I want us to remember that these laws had expired because they had been fulfilled in Jesus Christ our Lord. Actually, as we continue, you will understand that Paul is telling us, you know what, these were simply a shadow pointing us to the reality which is found in Jesus Christ our Lord. So Paul tells us, before Christ came, yes, we did that. But now that Christ is here, the law has been fulfilled in him. And so do not be deceived. Don't let people judge you by what you eat or drink. Now I know many of us point fingers to people that eat some of those foods that had been prohibited. I have a friend who actually says, because I eat pork, I will go to hell. Do not be judged by what you eat or what you drink. The Mosaic law had rules, and one as such rule was the rule that related to food. You all know there were foods that were clean and unclean. But I want to thank God for Jesus Christ our Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Friends, if you read with me Acts chapter 10, you will see that as Peter receives a vision from the Lord, verses 9 to 15, Acts 10, Jesus in this vision tells Peter, why do you consider unclean something that I have made clean? Praise the Lord. And so this whole thing of food and considering certain things impure, God made clean. And so in the vision, he's told, wake up and eat, wake up and eat. And he's concerned because he has that mentality from the Old Testament. There were also rules that related to drinking. There were some vessels that were considered contaminated. And so if you drank from it, you would be punished. There were rules concerning drinking wine, drinking in moderation, small amounts. But also there were rules that related to how much a priest would drink, but also not drink at all. There were Jewish festivals, but also the essence of most of these ceremonies was the essence of sacrifice. The essence of bringing a sacrifice, either burnt or incomplete, so that people are made right with God. But friends, as we read the New Testament and 1 Corinthians 5, 7 to 8, we actually realize that Christ, the Passover lamb, was sacrificed for us. And so there is no need for us to continue doing this over and over again. There were celebrations of the new moon and keeping of the Sabbath and many, many other festivals. But Paul tells us, do not get stuck in the time. Christ came to us. He is the ultimate sacrifice. These were simply a shadow that pointed to Christ. But now that Christ is with us, he is our reality. So Paul calls these people here to actually understand that they ought not to focus on these festivals, but rather to focus on Jesus Christ. Because the festivals were but just a shadow, and yet Christ is the reality that they ought to deal with and appreciate. Now, some of these laws in the Old Testament actually helped people keep order. They actually helped people behave well. They protected them from contamination, from danger, from being taken advantage of, and many other things. And so one of the concerns of the people, why they didn't want to stop, is they thought to themselves, now, if these laws are taken away from us, how are we going to control people's behaviors? How are people going to live? What will they fashion their lives upon? But friends, I want to remind us that in Christ, what controls us is love. It is the Spirit of God, but also the law that Christ gives to us. The law, the love of Christ will compel us to behave in a way that shows that we are those that have come to his knowledge. And not necessarily the rules. I want to tell you that people will adhere to the rules at times only in the presence of the person that makes the rules. But as the person making the rules walks out, lo and behold, they will forget and they continue to do otherwise. And so Paul is telling us, you know what, love is the ultimate thing. The love that we have for Christ will compel us to behave well with our neighbors, but also to keep the law of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, friends, the reason we want to live well, but also to please the Lord, is because we are overwhelmed with gratitude over what he has done for us. If you kind of open your pages of scripture back to 1 Corinthians and you read verses 13 to 14, you will see something great that Christ accomplished for us. In those verses, we are told that he rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of God, the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And so people at Colossae were worried. Eat this, don't eat this, observe the other. And they were kind of putting their focus more on this Jewish kind of tradition, and yet emphasis and focus had to be put on Christ Jesus. And Paul tells them, you know what? Observing the new moon will not save you. It is not what actually saved you. It is Jesus Christ that laid down his life for you, and so you ought to focus on him. Leave those things alone. They were but just a shadow pointing us to the reality. And so he tells them that Christ should be the center of their focus and not human rules, those that would not actually save them. Now, the second problem at this church, apart from legalism that had to deal with rules and regulations on what to eat and certain other things, they had another problem. The second problem is that appealed to emotions. Appealed to emotions, that heresy of mysticism. And this is clearly written for us in verse 18. Verse 18 says, do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you. Such a person also goes into great detail about what they have seen. They are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind. Notice that line of disqualify you. And what comes to mind is the sports language, the idea of having a referee or umpire judging as to whether a certain, maybe badminton serve is correct or not. And is telling us the kind of people that are judging you are not those that are qualified. You know you ought to have a referee that is trained in football to actually know if such a penalty deserves, free kick and some of those things. But the referees that are judging your standards are actually not qualified. Why are they not qualified? Because they are worshiping angels. He tells them, you do not want to invest your life, to invest your energies in a life that will at the end of the day be disqualified, because you are being judged by someone who is not qualified. And part of the error that the people judging were involved in is angel worship. They had this concept that you could not get to God personally. You needed to kind of go through a medium. You needed to go through kind of a medium. And for them, this medium was not Jesus Christ. This medium was angels. Because they thought angels are closer to God, so if you worship angels, they will take your petitions to the Lord. And that is not what the Christian faith teaches us. Christ tells us in Scripture that we cannot get to the Father except through him. It is not written for us in Scripture that we cannot get to the Father except through angels. But the believers at Colossae had people twisting the truth, telling them, you ought to have a certain experience of worshiping angels. You ought to see some angels as you sleep. You ought to have some visions. You ought to have trances. That kind of emotional feeling. And if you did not stand up to say, you know what, I had an encounter with the angel, they considered you less saved. And those that had such encounters felt that they were superior because they would have encounters with these beings. Now, friends, I want to say that Paul mentions and tells them, do not cherish these experiences of angels. The angels have nothing to do with our salvation, friends. Our salvation has everything to do with Jesus Christ, our Lord. And he tells them, you know what, the people that are worshiping angels and calling you to do the same are simply letting their unspiritual mind puff them up with idle notions. But this does not mean, friends, that as we worship the Lord, that we may not experience emotions. Many times as we stand before him and lift up holy hands, there is that kind of experience that we have. And it is a good experience. Now, the danger or challenge is considering yourself to be superior or more saved, because as we worshiped, you raised hands and tears started coming out, and those that have not had such an encounter, you consider them less saved. Emotions have their place in our faith. They do have their place. But the emotions that Paul is dealing with are those emotions that came to these people, not at the point of encountering Christ, but at the point of encountering angels. Can you imagine? And Paul tells them, angel worship has nothing to do with our salvation. Our salvation is in Christ and Christ alone. Praise the Lord. Amen. Our salvation is in Christ and in Christ alone. And so you ought to be careful. In verse 19, he kind of gives us the reason why some people were actually teaching these crazy things, these crazy ideas. And you might be asking yourself, why would someone tell people that worship the angel, he or she, the angel will lead you to the Lord? Why were they teaching this? And the reason Paul gives clearly to us in verse 19. Read with me verse 19. Verse 19 says, they have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body is supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. These people are perverting the truth because they are not connected to the head. And we all know who the head is. That is Christ our Lord. They have not plugged into the source of truth. And that is why they are moving about teaching all kinds of untrue things. And friends, we ought to be careful. The moment you lose connection with the head, you are finished. Now, you might not be finished physically. You might not see you dead, but you will be spiritually dead. So Paul tells us they are doing all this because they have lost connection with the head, who is Jesus Christ. But as Paul mentions this in between those lines, I can see Paul telling us of how we grow spiritually. And he mentions two ways that are not directly here, but I would like us to notice. The first way Paul tells us we grow spiritually is if we are connected to the head, and that is Jesus Christ our Lord. But the other second way is if we are connected as a body of Christ. Now you know that you and me and all of us make up the body, and that means we ought to be connected with Christ the head, but also grow in fellowship with each other as a body of Christ. Growth happens if we are first connected to the head, and secondly, if we are connected to each other as the body of Christ. No wonder scripture tells us iron sharpens iron. And that is only at the place of fellowship as you try to grow together as a body of Christ. Now, the last problem, the last kind of heresy they had, even as I plan to finish, is what is called asceticism. Now, asceticism is severe self-discipline, and it has everything to do with avoiding all forms of indulgence, and it is typically done for religious reasons. You kind of want to punish yourself, to kind of punish your body, so that in the process of your body receiving pain, you feel like the guilt has been taken away from you. Kind of saying, you know what, God, I stole someone's pen, but I will go a week without food, so that you kind of feel the pain and you get that consolation of, you know what, because I have harshly treated my body, probably the guilt has gone. Now, many of them did certain things to their bodies harshly so that they could be made right with God. Listen to verses 20 to 23, the caution Paul gives them. Paul says, since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not touch, do not test these rules, which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations, indeed, have an appearance of wisdom with their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body, but they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. Harsh treatment of the body. So Paul tells them, you know what? Even when you do that to your body, it will not take the guilt away. And at times we want to punish ourselves for the wrongs we do, thinking that will make us right with God. Friends, the error here is not knowing that Christ paid the penalty for our sins, and that in Christ we stand free. By harshly punishing your body, you're claiming to take on the place of Christ, which you can never take. Christ paid the penalty for us. And so what I see Paul calling us to in these verses, he is calling us to find our security in Christ and in Christ alone. He is telling us the rules and regulations will not save us. Legalism will take us nowhere. The worship of angels and wanting to have those kind of experiences and priding in them will not save us. The angels didn't die for us. Wanting to kind of self-discipline ourselves by punishing ourselves will not take us anywhere. But I see him calling us to Christ and Christ alone. He tells us to leave the shadows alone and go with our reality that is found in Jesus Christ our Lord. So friends, my prayer for myself and for you this afternoon is that the Lord will open our eyes to the reality of who Christ is, to the reality of what Christ accomplishes for us. And like Paul beseeches these Christians at Colossae, that we will desire to be rooted and built up in the faith that we received, so that as these wrong teachers come our way, we will be strengthened, we will be firm, and none of us will fall. None of us will be found missing. To the glory and honor of our Lord Jesus Christ. May God bless you.